Yeah. All righty, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Astronomy on Tap. We're all happy to have you here. Some nice cold weather we're having. Finally kind of feel like winter out here in the South. So we have two really cool talks today. We have one by our department chair at LSU, for physics and astronomy at LSU, and one by another faculty member. So, you know, he's got a lot to follow up. He's department chair and then just our faculty member. So, you know, but they're both great talks. It's going to be great. And of course, we always have our trivia in the middle. And we will have a raffle, so make sure you hold on to those raffle tickets, and trivia will be at intermission. Also, we do have a new tip war like we do every month. So today's tip war is not really space themed. It's going to settle that debate of what's the best Thanksgiving meat, turkey or ham. So we will be going around. We have our voting at the merch table, and also voting, we'll bring around the jars around, during intermission as well. So please vote. We got to figure out which one. Our winner of last month's tip war was the Witch Heads versus Bat Nebula, and the Bat Nebula won by a lot. So we had the Bat Nebula won, which was awesome. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and introduce our first speaker. So we have Jeff Blackmon. He is the chair of the Department of Physics and Astronomy at LSU. He's an experimental nuclear physicist who studies subatomic processes important for astrophysics. He received his PhD from the University of North Carolina and was on Franklin Street when Dean Smith won his second national championship in 1993. So please give it up for Jeff.
All right. Thank you very much for coming out. So I'm going to tell you today about potential solutions to a big problem with the Big Bang, and I will start this by saying that I am not a cosmologist, and I am an experimental nuclear physicist, so you may ask me cosmology questions, and some of you may know more than me, so we'll see how that goes, okay? So I'm going to start by telling you not so much about the problems and the potential solutions, but about things we do know about the Big Bang, because any solution we come up with to the problems is going to have to not screw up the other stuff. So our understanding of the Big Bang is we have observations from three very different epochs and times. So one thing we can do is we can look at old stars and old galaxies, and we do that by looking far away. So if we look at objects that are far away in the universe, it takes a long time for that light to get to us, and so we observe stars at an earlier time. The other thing we can do is we observe something called the cosmic microwave background. This is essentially a snapshot of the universe from a very narrow window of time when the universe went from becoming very opaque to very transparent, and all the light that came from that particular period of time, then we get a snapshot from this very unique period. So that gives us another piece of information. If we want to look even earlier in time, what we look at is we can look at the formation of the elements, which happened in just the very first few minutes after the Big Bang. So each of those pieces gives us a piece of information that tells us about the Big Bang that supports the theory. So let's start with the observations. This takes us back the earliest in terms of the history. So the observations of the Big Bang, Edwin Hubble first developed basically an empirical law, looking at the Doppler shift of light coming from galaxies compared to their distance from us. And what really made this possible was the fact that at that time there was a relationship developed for variable stars called the Cepheid variables that allowed us to relate their luminosity to their period. So by measuring the period of those stars, we were able to tell what their brightness was, and then by looking at how bright they were in the sky, Hubble was able to pin down accurately their distance. And then he measured the frequency or wavelength of light coming from those. And because they were moving, he measured a Doppler shift, just like the frequency of a siren as an ambulance go by changes because of its speed. the wavelength and frequency and light of these objects was different because they were moving. And what he found was an empirical relationship that everything seemed to be moving away from us, and the further away something was from us, the faster it was moving away from us. And this data didn't look very impressive, maybe, perhaps, but over time, we developed better and better data looking at further and further distances, and this law has held, known as the Hubble law, which is that the further away something is, the faster it is moving away from us. And so just a couple years later, the data looked like this. This is pushing the distance scale now a factor of 10 longer. And now we have data that have pushed the distance scale much, much further, 100 times longer than Hubble originally measured. And that law has still held. The further away something is, the faster it's moving. And this leads to the conclusion that the universe is expanding. And it's been expanding at a relatively constant rate, which means that at previous times, the universe was smaller and it was denser. Now, in the 90s, this changed a little bit in that people have observations at very far distances with a particular type of supernova, and they were able to determine that that expansion rate is not exactly constant. It seems to actually be increasing. And so this is the first change from the Hubble law, that the rate was proportional to the distance. Now we see at very large distances there are change. And that was perhaps somewhat controversial at the time, but what really led to that being accepted was the measurements of the cosmic microwave background. So this is the light that comes from the transition when the universe went from being opaque to being clear, and at that point we get a snapshot of what the universe looks like. And you may have seen a picture like this of the universe that has this amazing structure all throughout the universe. And we can then try to describe that with a model of the Big Bang. And a two-dimensional plot is a little bit hard to analyze, so often what we do is we condense that two-dimensional plot into a one-dimensional plot, which is what the figure shows, which is just correlating basically the distance with the relative fluctuations in the light that we observe. And what you see is that on different distance scales, you see a difference in the fluctuation of the light. And the important thing to note here is the data points on the plot show you what comes from the observations of the cosmic microwave background. And the line here is a calculation using only six parameters. And those are the six parameters of the standard, or what's sometimes called the Lambda CDM Big Bang model. And with those six parameters, it perfectly describes the spectrum that we see. That tells us a lot about the composition of the universe, and it's somewhat surprising. Only 5% of the universe, energy and matter, is stuff that we know about, atoms, basically. And the other 95% is something else. 25% of it is made up of something called dark matter. Well, that's things that interact with gravity, but it's not a particle that we otherwise know. It's something that has to be weakly interacting that we have not observed in our world so far. And then the other 70% is this: somehow at large distances, we see the universe expanding at a rapid rate. So there's some amount of repulsion that we don't exactly understand. So this model now is describing all of the data from stars and galaxies, and it's describing what we see in the cosmic microwave background, but it's weird, right? 95% of the stuff is stuff we don't know anything about, and we don't know what it is. So we should test this in other ways. And a third way that we can test this then is to look at the formation of the elements that happens just minutes after the Big Bang. So initially, the universe is very hot and dense, and the only things that are around are fundamental particles. But once it cools off enough, we can start to assemble heavier things together. And there's a very narrow window of time where we can do that until the universe becomes so cool and things are so spread out that no more interactions really occur. And so at that point, we are forming the initial light elements that make up the universe. By and large, what happens is that all the initial neutrons get gobbled up to make helium. And that's really the bulk of what happens. 75% of what's left over in the universe is the initial protons that were formed, and those neutrons get gobbled up into helium-4. But one thing that gives us a very sensitive probe of those initial conditions is some of the other much less abundance elements. In particular, one that's very important is the fusion of hydrogen with the protons with the neutrons to make hydrogen 2, deuterium, a heavy form of hydrogen. This then goes on, and by and large, to be incorporated into helium and other things, but there's a little bit of deuterium that's left over. Another thing that happens is, in a very small fraction, the heliums can form together. And putting two helium 4s together doesn't give you something that's stable, but putting together a helium 3 and a helium 4 gives you an isotope called beryllium 7. It's a radioactive isotope of beryllium that lasts for about 2 months, but it decays to make lithium. And this is where we believe the bulk of lithium in the universe comes from, was in the initial Big Bang. The fusion of helium together created lithium, and the lithium we observe in the universe is a relic then of the initial fusion from the Big Bang. So now we can test this. We can go out and look in the universe and measure the abundance of these things. And does this agree with this Big Bang model, the 6-parameter Big Bang model that describes the other observations? And the answer is yes and no. So if we look at the abundance of deuterium, which is shown on the left, what we measure exactly agrees with what we predict from the Big Bang model. So what's plotted is the distribution or the likelihood that we have this amount of stuff versus the amount of stuff. So on the left is deuterium, and what you see is that these two distributions overlap perfectly. So our predictions overlap perfectly with what we expect, whereas on the right-hand side, not even close at all. So the Big Bang predicts that we should see 3 times as much lithium as what we observe in the universe. And if you look at sort of the overlap, these two distributions really don't overlap at all. The probability that these two things agree is very, very, very small, less than 1 part in 300. So our observations do not agree with what we observe. And this is one of the glaring problems with the Big Bang model. What happened to the lithium? We expect 3 times more lithium to be produced than we actually observe. There are many theories, and I'm going to talk about a few of them, but let's just say that there's not much evidence to support any of them. So this is an ongoing mystery. So what might be going on? Well, one answer, a good place to always start, is blame the astronomers. That's where I always start, right? They're probably wrong, right? Somehow the astronomers are wrong. Well, let's see what the observations are and how they might be wrong. So one thing that's peculiar about the lithium is that we're observing lithium in the atmospheres of stars, and we want to observe lithium that is left over from the Big Bang. And the way we do that is not like you would think from what I talked about earlier. We don't observe things that are far away. Instead, we observe stars that have very little iron in them. So iron is produced all the time by supernovas. Supernovas are going out all the time, making iron. And so if you look at a star that has a lot of iron in it, it's relatively young because it's been formed after a lot of supernova. And so what you instead want to do is look at a star that has very little iron, and that is believed to be a star that is formed early in the history of the universe. And so the plot here shows observations of lithium. The plot just shows the amount of lithium versus the amount of iron. And what you see is what we expect. There should be a slight correlation. Actually, as the iron goes up, the lithium should go up. And the reason for that is there are other processes that will go along and also create lithium when the iron is creating. So the trend sort of makes sense. But if you look at the plot, the line, the flat line, that's what we expect. None of the observations are anywhere close to the line, right? They're a factor of 3 off. It's not like some astronomer made a mistake observing some star, right? There has to be some systematic problem. Well, the observations, we can only observe neutral lithium in the stars. But lithium comes in different ionization states. You have lithium in the stars where an electron is moved, and we can't observe that. We have lithium where 2 electrons are observed. We can't observe that.
we're only observing the neutral hydrogen, neutral lithium in this case, in the stars. And we have to make a correction for that. And it's a big correction. Maybe it's off. I mean, we don't think so. There's a lot of, reasons to say it shouldn't be off, but that's a possibility. So we could blame the astronomers. That's one possibility. Another possibility is the stars did it. So this lithium that we're observing, I said this is not far stars. These are stars typically in our own galaxy or local neighborhood. And the theory is the lithium we're observing in the atmosphere is the lithium these stars were formed with. We think these low metallicity stars do not mix material from the outside to the inside, and the outside sort of preserves what they were formed with. So the idea is we observe a star that in its outside has low metals, okay? Well, it has low iron, and the lithium then is representative of what it was formed with. Well, there was some way to mix that lithium inside, maybe it could be destroyed. And part of the counter argument, this is very hard to do because we've observed many stars, many different metallicities, and the trend is so good. If there was some mixing mechanism that was driving lithium into the star, it would be hard to see how it would be so consistent from star to star. So that's one problem with making this particular model work. Another solution is we were robbed, okay? So the lithium that we're observing, I just said, well, this is very different than any of the other cosmological observations we make. The other cosmological observations, we're actually observing things throughout the cosmos, throughout the universe, in different places. With the lithium, we're just observing stars that are in our galaxy. And those stars have low amounts of lithium. Well, maybe there's something unusual about the Milky Way. This is then a possibility. The lithium would perhaps agree with our Big Bang model throughout the universe, but for some reason, the way the Big Bang works, it had to move that lithium somewhere else, and we had a small amount. This is kind of, people don't like to say we're special, right? That would always be a solution to any problem. We could say, oh, well, the Milky Way is just different than everywhere else, right? That doesn't seem to be a really satisfactory solution. Why would we happen to be so special and have such low lithium? And now there are some new observations looking at lithium further away, and it seems to agree with the Milky Way value. So that also seems to say that this is not a likely solution. Another solution people consider is we could change fundamental constants or statistics. That sounds crazy, right? We're going to just change fundamental constants. It's not as crazy as it sounds because, in fact, fundamental constants do vary with energy and scale and other things. And there are reasons to believe that maybe they could change, but it would take a very particular change in fundamental constants a particular way to fix the lithium problem and not screw other stuff up. So that also seems sort of fishy. The other solution is the dark matter did it. I just told you that 25% of the universe is something we don't understand. Particles that have matter, but they don't have, they don't interact in other ways. It's weakly interacting, so how could it influence the lithium? Well, there's a lot of it, right? It's weakly interacting, but it's 25% of the matter in the universe, so maybe it just preferentially destroys the lithium. That would work, but again, the dark matter would have to have particularly specific properties to make that happen. Seems a little bit tuned, okay, to make it work, but it is a possibility. And this brings me to the sixth idea that I'll spend just an extra minute on, which is maybe there is a nuclear surprise. So in the distributions I showed back earlier about what's expected versus what's predicted, people have included every possible known uncertainty in calculating what we expect from the Big Bang. So everything that we know that we don't know, we have included an uncertainty, and we have modeled that. However, there may be things that we do not know and therefore we have not included them in our model. So it is the unknown unknowns that may be getting us. And so maybe there's some process in the Big Bang that destroys lithium that we haven't included because we don't know about it. And those uncertainties or that process then may make things in agreement. And there's one particular idea that I'll talk about, which is that maybe this heavy version of hydrogen, deuterium, or hydrogen proton and a neutron, could interact with the beryllium, which becomes the lithium, and destroy it to turn it back into hydrogen, into protons and helium. And this is a process that happens in the Big Bang, but is not believed to be very important because there's not very much of this heavy hydrogen, this deuterium around to make reactions happen. You know, if we do estimates of that, we expect it to be 100 times too weak to be able to solve the problem. So there's been one measurement of this that was done in the 60s that did not happen at the energies that happened in Big Bang. And people made an extrapolation back based on that and said, oh, this is 100 times too weak. But extrapolations can be far off. So what we've done is to actually measure this in the laboratory using a beam of beryllium-7, and we put it onto a chamber filled with deuterium gas, and we looked at those reactions creating helium and helium and hydrogen, all of those breakup products, and we measure 6 interactions at once, and from measuring those 6 interactions, we're able to determine exactly where in the gas the reaction happened, and we were able to measure this over a significant fraction of the energies that are important for Big Bang. We lowered the energy range a factor of 2 from what had been measured previously, and what we found is that the rate of this reaction was 10 times bigger than people expected before. That's a huge factor that's different. People thought, oh, it can't be that far off, but it's a factor of 10 off is our estimate. That does not solve the lithium problem, though. What we needed for this particular process is it needed to be 100 times bigger. So a 10 times effect change in the rate of the reaction actually only reduces the lithium by about 10 or 20%. But our measurement did not cover the full range. And I should say at this point that this is the work of 2 Florida State graduate students that need a lot of shout out for this, Naveen Rajal and Gordon McCann. So they were the ones that really did a lot of the hard work that make this happen. We want to be able to push this measurement, though, to go through all the Big Bang energies so we can put to rest whether or not there's another factor of 10 lurking where we did not measure. And so to do that, we're taking this measurement to Canada. So a facility called TRIOMPH, which is Canada's National Lab for Nuclear and Particle Physics, has the world's largest cyclotron, and they can make 100 times more beryllium-7 than we've had at Florida State. And so we have an approved experiment now to go and measure this reaction using a slightly different technique. We're actually going to use a very thin target, in this case a solid film that has deuterium. And they have so much beam that we're just going to change the beam energy and measure the reaction at every possible energy we need and see whether this factor of 10 is lurking somewhere in this reaction. So in summary, there's production of lithium is a significant problem in the Big Bang, and there are a lot of ideas about how that might be solved, but none of them are good. So far, there's no model that seems likely. And the question is, you know, is there something else that we haven't considered? Is there some completely different solution? Maybe we need a different idea, or maybe some combination of all of these. And I'll conclude by saying thanks to a lot of people that really helped in making this work possible.
All right. Oh, there's the sound. All right. Just deafing myself up here. All right. Now we have time for question and answers. So are there any questions in the audience? And Jude, we will get to your question at the very end. Don't worry. Any questions? Don't see any online just yet. You're going to bring. Yes.
I would bet that it's not a single solution.
No, I bet there's not a single solution. It seems too unlikely that there's one magic thing that's going to make everything better. I think there's probably a number of things that are not quite right.
Any other questions from our audience? Yes.
Do you look at the white space of the carbon cloud? Because there is a node that carbon cloud also mentioned.
I guess something about carbon 12, that's all I got. So in the Big Bang, we really don't expect, it's lithium is one part in 10 billionth of what's made in the Big Bang. So if you look at the possibility of making carbon, that would require another fusion of helium. That would be another factor of 10,000 down. So the amount of carbon and heavy elements that's formed seems to be completely negligible. So people are looking at revisions to the Big Bang model, and there are lots of ideas about how to change things. Inhomogeneities is one big thing that people have considered. People are looking actively at a lot of these revisions to the model, and the catch is fixing the lithium without messing the other things up is very difficult to do, and that's why I think most people are migrating towards, if that happens, it makes the Milky Way a special place.
Any other questions? Jude?
What is your favorite Pokemon?
What is your favorite Pokemon? It's our traditional Astronomy on Tap question.
Pikachu.
All right, let's give another round of applause for Jeff. All right. I don't even need to hold that anywhere. All right, so next we're going to do our trivia. Is this better? All right. Okay. So next we're going to have our trivia. It's going to be playing on our screen up here. When you are done with your trivia, please write your name on the top and return it to our merch table. There is a chance to win a prize. We did just get our new pint glasses in, so if you have not checked those out, come check it out in the back. And we will also be doing our tip war, so use intermission, go refresh your drinks, grab some food, play some trivia, and we'll be back shortly.
Thank you.
seats if you were told that you need to sign in the back. We do have the list of names, so you can stop by the merch table after the next talk to sign in. And with that, I will go ahead and introduce our next speaker. So our next speaker is Justin Wilson. He grew up in Texas, went to undergrad at Texas A&M, which is, you know, relevant for this upcoming Thanksgiving football game this weekend, or next weekend. It's not Thanksgiving yet. He did his grad school at the University of Maryland and his postdocs at Caltech and Rutgers. He's a reformed quantum gravity theorist, now a condensed matter theorist. He plays video games and has been since the first Nintendo Entertainment System. He particularly loves Final Fantasy games, and he's played all of the main series games. So give it up for Justin.
All right, let's see how this... Hello, I'm Justin Wilson, and I will be talking today about the strange connection between gravity and fluid flow. But before I really get into it, I just wanted to give a little bit of a little bit more detail on my own background and how I sort of came to this, because I'm now a condensed matter theorist, and so you don't really think of us doing gravity usually. We do more like down-to-earth systems. Ashley said, I started out my undergrad at Texas A&M, and I went to grad school at the University of Maryland, where I really wanted to do gravity, and I was like working with a gravitational theorist there. And then I got really interested in condensed matter stuff and switched fields there. But then I went to Caltech for a postdoc. After that, Rutgers, and finally came here for a faculty position. But that's where I was physically. But my research trajectory was more along these lines. So on here on the y-axis, I have like the scale of energy, which was the research I was looking at, and on the x-axis, we have where I was, or undergrad, grad school, or beyond. So I started out doing something called the Casimir effect. It's not really all that relevant to this talk, but it's maybe like middle energy kind of stuff. But then I really wanted to do quantum gravity, figuring out how to put quantum mechanics together with gravity. So I went to grad school to do this, which is as high energy as you could possibly get. But as I was doing this, I was like interested in like how could space-time like emerge from stuff. And it turned out that when I took this is a little bit messed up, it looks like, but whenever I was taking some condensed matter classes, I was seeing that there's actually things that can emerge in condensed matter systems that didn't make any sense. Like you might have sound waves in a material, and they'll behave like light particles. They're called phonons instead of photons. Like these just sort of come out, and they behave quantum mechanically very similar to photons do. And I was like, oh, this is very interesting. You can actually get stuff emerging in these like materials. So I came down in energy to condensed matter, and now I think about a whole bunch of things to do with both quantum materials, quantum computing. But what this talk is about, analog gravity, where you can actually have emergent space-time and emergent geometry. So I also want to mention the late Phil Anderson, who he coined the term condensed matter theory. And the big thing that he sort of brought to the table here is written in his article called More is Different. It's a popular article. You could actually read it, and it makes there's a couple of things in there that might be a little hard to understand, but it's not so bad. But he was mostly saying that instead of, you know, looking at smaller and smaller energy to figure out how the world works, like all you really need to do for fundamental physics is to look at how a whole bunch of things work together. So if you put a lot of electrons together, just plain old electrons, things can behave much different than you might suspect by looking at single electrons. So instead of looking at bigger and bigger colliders, you might just look how electrons themselves can like interact with each other and with whole seas of electrons. But let's get to the main show here, which is with analog gravity. So to understand analog gravity, let's first talk a little bit about what gravity is, or how we understand gravity now. So you might have seen pictures like this where you have the Earth, some ball of mass, and it sort of, you can imagine this as like a bed sheet where you put some heavy ball in the middle, it deforms it a bit, and this represents the gravitational field. So if you put another little ball somewhere on here, it'll roll towards the Earth just as it would fall towards the Earth. And this very nicely captures one of the effects of gravity, which is it doesn't care how much mass you have or anything. You'll fall with the same speed. If you send light in, it'll be deflected off of the Earth just the same as very similar to that kind of stuff as well. And so this is how like gravity itself is kind of like a geometry of the problem. So one thing that we can do is think about also what happens with light. So like imagine that you just turn on the light bulb. Now light is extremely fast, so it looks like it illuminates the room just instantaneously. But it doesn't. We know now that light has a finite speed, so it takes it a while to get across the room. It's really, really, really fast. But like it goes out from the light bulb in a sphere until it encompasses the whole room, and it goes out at the speed of light. And when you're in your room, you sort of see this happening. So we want to think about what that means when we're in a gravitational field itself. So now imagine that you're on some ball that's going around some other big ball. I don't know, has anyone actually been on a big ball that's going around another one? Raise of hands if you have. Oh, a few people. Okay, that's good. That's good to know. There's this one here called Earth that I think some people have maybe visited. So if you're on this and you're going around in the gravitational field, you're actually falling towards the sun all the time and just never hitting it. And one thing you can do while you're falling towards the sun is turn on the light bulb. And when you turn on that light bulb, you see that the light waves go out in what looks like a sphere to you. It looks like the same as it would as if you weren't on this ball that's hurling through space. This is actually called the equivalence principle, where the fact that we're accelerating towards the sun, we're falling towards the sun. This looks the same as if we're not in a gravitational field whatsoever. So now let's think about how we can relate this to other systems. So instead of a light bulb now, I want you to think about a stream or just a still pool of water. And you come in and you drop a little drop in there, and it makes a ripple that then goes out in a circle. You can actually see the ripples this time instead of with like the light where it takes it virtually instantaneously across the whole room. Now we can actually watch these waves as they go through the liquid itself. And these ripples, so you should think of these as if they are light rays, but now they're kind of more density waves on the surface of the liquid, and they go out in a circle. So we now want to think about what can be an equivalent equivalence principle. Like, so now instead of a ball that's being hurled through space, what it would be a similar thing here. So one of these is actually, we have one really nearby, a river, where the water is flowing down the river. And so here is an example of a river. And if we imagine that we sit on a particularly calm portion of this river, say here, and we go with the flow, we sort of let the river take us down, then we can look locally just at our little, what looks like a relatively still amount of water, and ask what happens if we drop a little drop of water on there. Well, if we're not in a particularly rough portion, so we're not in the rapids or anything, then it should look like we have a little ripple that starts going out in a circle. It's moving with the river, but it's also going out in a little circle. This is very similar to how gravity works. And so this is kind of the equivalence principle, but now for water and for water waves. So one other way that you might actually have experienced something that's kind of like this is in a lazy river. So who has been in a lazy river? More people than have been on a ball hurling through space. It's amazing. So if you're just in a tube that is going down the lazy river, it feels like you're not moving, right? You're just sort of lounging there. You're like drinking either a beer or some nice beverage or whatnot. It's a good time. But then, I don't know if you've done this. I love to do this when I was lazy in lazy rivers. You go to the side and you grab onto the side, and you can all of a sudden, as you're like holding onto the side, you can feel the water start to pull you. It's trying to pull you down the river. So that is very similar to how, like, when we're here on Earth, we're being pulled down, but we're being held up by the Earth itself. So it's like you're hanging off a cliff, kind of. So that's another way that you can think about how the fluid itself is acting, in a sense, like a gravitational field. The flow itself is actually trying to drag you along, just the same as the geometry of space-time is trying to pull you towards the Earth all the time. Okay, so this is cute, I guess. We have some stuff going on with that looks very similar between gravity and fluid flow. But can we think of more exotic phenomenon? We like to do things that can get us into nice articles where we say black holes or cosmic expansion and whatnot. So we do that. So let's think about a black hole. So does anyone know what a black hole is? What its key property is? Yeah, so nothing can escape it. Yes, not even light can escape a black hole. So you have like a star that, I don't know the details, you can ask an astronomer for the details of how stars collapse. But at a certain point, stars can fully collapse down to a single point in space. And the gravitational field becomes so strong that not even light can escape it. And in fact, there's something called the event horizon, where if you were to actually put a single like photon of light there and have it try to escape, it would just sit there. It wouldn't fall in. It wouldn't escape. It would just sit there. But if you nudge it a little bit, it'll escape. Or if you nudge it towards the black hole, it'll go down and get eaten by the black hole. So what we want to do is see if we can do something like this in a fluid system where we can actually have an event horizon and a singularity. I don't know if anyone has any guesses for what this looks like in a fluid system. You might actually see it every day. Yeah, exactly, a drain. So in fact, here is a drain where you have water circling in and falling down. So where it's actually falling down in the drain, that behaves kind of like your singularity. You're kind of losing all of the water into that point. And there's also a point which we can call an event horizon here. And so this is actually a point where if we had a little fish or something that's trying to like swim upstream, before the event horizon, it can always swim upstream. It can always get out. But the moment it crosses that, it can no longer swim upstream. In order to actually get out, it would have to break free of the fluid and actually find some other way out. So that's like one instance. We can think of very similar instances as well. So let's see. So this here is a waterfall. This is a video that I took recently at an analog gravity workshop that we had in Spain. Oh, wow. So a couple of seconds here. But you can imagine that on the top part of this video, you actually have a place where fish could actually escape and swim back. But if at a certain point, you'll start to go over the edge, and you'll be swallowed by the waterfall. There's no way without breaking free of the waterfall that you could possibly swim back up, and you'll go over the side. So you might also ask what happens, like, what does that mean for the bottom of a waterfall? Well, so this is the same waterfall now, but the bottom of it, I don't know if you know what actually happens at the bottom of the waterfall. So, but at the bottom here, you actually will have a point where the water will slow down. And so there's actually a second event horizon over there, and this horizon is different. This isn't one where fish can't swim back up. This is one where no fish can enter. So it can't actually swim, start to swim up the waterfall there. Just not possible at all. This is equivalent of what would be a white hole and general relativity, which is something where only light can escape it instead of the opposite, where all light gets like sucked into it. Well, not exactly sucked, but you know. So these are like two of the analog examples that we have where you could see something like a black hole. And so let's think a little bit about how this works. And so this is a much more calm waterfall here, where we have here what I'm labeling as black hole and white hole. These are actually the event horizons. So there actually isn't a singularity in the white hole case, or in this case. So anything that goes through the black hole is like spit out the white hole. It doesn't collapse onto some point. And so over here on the right, this blue block, let's think about this as just some still bit of water. And if I take this still bit of water and I just take part of it down a bit, then the water starts to flow down. And as it speeds up, it reaches some kind of equilibrium where there's a certain point, this red line here, where nothing can now, it's going so fast that not even the ripples that I was showing you before could possibly go back up the waterfall. All the ripples, even the ones that would be going in that direction, are actually being kind of flushed all the way down the waterfall to the left. And this was actually realized by a famous physicist called Bill Unruh in this paper, Experimental Black Hole Evaporation, that he figured this out while he was teaching a hydrodynamics class to some people. And he's like, these equations look very familiar. I think I've seen these in a black hole situation. So there's a couple of things we can also see. So this you might recognize this a little bit from one of the trivia slides, but you can ask what you might see in a black hole. One thing is this thing called spaghettification, where when you go to a black hole, as you approach the singularity, the tidal effects become so strong that they sort of stretch you out, and they eventually like will rip you apart. Could be kind of graphic, I guess, or you know, we just draw nice pictures of astronauts being stretched. But the a picture of this for the analogous case is in this video here. So you can see like this moss that's going down this waterfall. As it goes down, it starts to like be spread out and spaghettify, just as it would be kind of in a black hole case. So you can see similar features in these kind of models. So people have actually been doing experiments on this, and this is even recent experiments. You might actually have to press play on this. Oh, it'll work. So this is a black hole in a bathtub, and I'll just let this video play for just a few minutes, because this is really cool stuff, I think.
We don't have a black hole, the surface waves behave as if there were a black hole in the system. So that's enough to give rise to these interesting effects, and we can then study these effects. So although we don't have a black hole, we still get the same effects that occur around black holes. Showed that super radiance does exist in our vortex flow. So this was quite a big result for us, because super radiance, it's been It's an effect that's been known about for, I think, since around the 1970s, but no one had ever actually demonstrated that it exists in these rotational systems from an experimental point of view.
Done by people at the University of Nottingham in the UK, and they so this effect of super radiance, like you use some waves to sort of pull out rotational energy from a rotating black hole, or in this case, this vortex flow in a bathtub. So let's get just a little bit more exotic, and so we want to ask: can we see quantum phenomenon that occur in weird gravitational systems? Before I show the next slide, I want to just mention one of the key aspects of quantum mechanics that I'll be kind of talking about. And that's if you've heard of like wave-particle duality, where sometimes particles behave like they're particles, sometimes they behave like they're waves. And this is one of the weird things of quantum mechanics. I want to just say a little bit, and this is the only time you'll see equations on this in this entire talk. So we have a tool to understand this wave-particle duality called quantum field theory. So it's a very complicated theory, but it's kind of how we understand the fact that particles can behave like both waves and particles. So to kind of get an idea for this, this is just a sine wave you might see in a trigonometry class. And you know, from trigonometry, if you remember, that we have an amplitude A, just a number that tells you how big the wave is, and we have lambda, which is the wavelength, which is how far you go from, say, crest to crest of the wave. So the main idea of quantum field theory is that we don't only have waves, sometimes things behave like particles. So instead of this amplitude and wavelength, we construct something called a quantum field, and the very cartoon version of this, excuse me, other theorists that are here, that this might be sacrilege to write. But now what we do is we put a little hat on top of this psi here, and we replace this number, A amplitude, with this other guy here. I'm going to call it A with a little dagger on it. And what this is now no longer a number that tells you how big the wave is. This is an operation, and this tells you to add a particle in. And so this one object has both the particle, which is the A dagger, and the wave, which is the cosine, all in one thing that we can then play around with and see what happens. So the reason that I bring this up is because the next thing I want to mention is something called the Hawking effect. Before I go on, I just want to mention that this idea of quantum field theory is something that we use to explain almost everything that you can imagine. So photons, electrons, gluons, protons, neutrinos, but also things that occur in condensed matter systems like sound waves called phonons. You can think of all sorts of different things that can occur. All of them we use quantum field theory to understand. So now let's talk about the Hawking effect. And so this, what kind of happens when you add quantum mechanics is you get kind of a sea of what we call quantum fluctuations, where in a very cartoon picture, like particles are sort of created and destroyed in little itty-bitty bubbles that are occurring all through space. But near black hole, we have a problem. If we make a little particle-antiparticle pair, one might be swallowed, and we know it can't escape the black hole if it's swallowed. All that's left is the other one must escape and become real, and we could actually see it. So this is actually an effect called that has the name Hawking from Stephen Hawking. This is one of the major things that he discovered. And this actually comes out of the black hole with a particular temperature. So you can measure these particles. Well, the temperature is so small that we probably won't ever see it in a real black hole. But in principle, you could measure this temperature coming off of black holes and see them. So on the other side of this, we have a waterfall. And then now the same thing is actually going to happen here, only now instead of these particles and antiparticles, these are now like sound waves or these little ripples. So these ripples, they also can behave quantum mechanically. And so they're getting created and destroyed in little pairs all the time as well. And sometimes one goes down the waterfall and the other one escapes. And so we should be able to actually measure this. And in fact, this is actually probably a little bit more plausible than measuring it in a real black hole. And in fact, people have. So in, I think, 2016, this one guy kind of by himself at the Technion Institute in Israel, he actually saw the quantum Hawking radiation in something called a superfluid, or a Bose-Einstein condensate in this case. This is actually, and I like to have, show a picture of what the experiment looks like. This is called an optical table. People put up a lot of lasers in order to then trap some atoms and make them behave like a fluid. So you trap some, maybe 1,000, maybe 10,000 if you're lucky, atoms, and you make them like move around as if they're a fluid. And they're actually, they behave more quantum mechanical than like the water that's like in the Mississippi, because they're well isolated from the environment. And it turns out that if you look at the copper thing in the bottom right picture, that's probably where the actual experiment is taking place. Everything else is there just for lasers to like bounce around and find their way to it. I don't know, experimentalists do something with them. So it turns out that people, that he actually saw this, and so I won't bore you with exactly what this plot is, but the main thing is on the right, we see that you can have the creation of a pair of particles, so the particle and antiparticle, or the sound wave and the anti-sound wave. It turns out the anti-sound wave is just a sound wave itself as well. And they go away from each other. One gets swallowed by the black hole, the other leaves, but they're actually quantum mechanically entangled with each other. And what this means is you can actually measure in this experiment what's called a correlation function, but you see where that green line is on the top there, this green line? There's a little dip that occurs there. And this dip, it goes down and up. This actually means that we see some entangled particles that are being created here, which is a key thing to show that there's a Hawking effect. Not only this, but he was able to show there's a Hawking temperature that follows exactly what you'd expect from a particular like, kind of black hole with a particular mass, but you have to make sure that it works for the analogous situation. So that was sort of the major thing that happened in 2016. This subject has kind of sort of blown up since. And so I just wanted to mention before I close a whole bunch of other systems in which people have looked at analog gravity. It's not just fluid flow. So we've seen here classical water waves. Actually, Bill Unruh, who wrote the original paper, did one of the first water experiments to see something called the stimulated Hawking effect, which is where you have to poke the system and you can see some particles get created. But now we've seen it in superfluids and even things like liquid helium. And there's a whole bunch of other systems that aren't even necessarily fluids where you could see something very similar. One is like nonlinear optics. You could see this in electromagnetic waveguides, a whole bunch of other things, even like superconductors, you can see things like this. But I don't have time to get into all those. I'd be happy to tell you about any of these systems in any amount of detail. But with that, I think I'll just close, and I'll just thank you for your time.
All right. We'll go ahead and open up for questions. If anybody in the audience has questions, I'm going to check our online audience.
Yeah, Tab. Yeah. Oh yes, they have a little thing on the side that's like making waves in the thing, so that because for super radiance you need to send in some waves, and you see that there's a bigger response out, so you get more waves coming out than you put into the system. Oh no. Yeah. Yeah, the radiance, that is. Yeah, they like to have the green light to make it look kind of cool. I think that is also kind of cool. But every time that it was like super radiance, it was really sound waves instead. So sometimes people even call these black holes, these analog black holes, they call them dumb holes, dumb as in deaf and dumb, which maybe not the best terminology, but you know, that's what some people call them. Oh, I don't know. That's a very good question, and I might just doubt it because you need some other kind of thing, and kind of the water waves themselves are kind of they're all behaving like massless particles, like photons and things like that. So actually having some massive stuff that's going around, I don't know if it, yeah, I don't exactly know, but I think probably not.
We do have a question online, so I'll look out. So we have a question from our online audience. So they ask, in GR, there's a question of whether information is destroyed if a horizon evaporates due to Hawking radiation. Has this been answered in analog systems?
This is a very good question. There are some analog systems where I think that you can't get at this answer. So like, for instance, the waterfall itself doesn't actually have a singularity that can then evaporate. So you couldn't actually see that occur, and it turns out that you will just sort of always see some scrambled information and not ever see this. But that's not to say that I don't think that you could have an analog situation where you could actually have something like a singularity form and then be destroyed over time, and that might actually give us some clues into what happens to the information that falls into the black hole. I think that's absolutely possible, but we don't have that yet.
All right, are there any other questions from our in-person audience? We'll get to yours in a second, Jude, I promise. All right, Jude, what's your favorite Pokemon?
So I could answer this really quickly, and the answer is Mew, but I have to give a little bit of a longer response. So I had thought about your question actually, but I actually didn't need to think about it that hard because I was in middle school when the first Pokemon came out, and I loved that game. I played it a lot. and I played Red, Blue, Yellow. I didn't really play the other generations nearly as much, but they didn't let you get Mew in that game. And I was very upset with this. You had to go to special events in other cities and whatnot in order to like get Mew. And I was in the middle of nowhere, Texas. No way I was going to that. So I got myself a Game Shark. I put the Game Shark on the Game Boy, put the thing in there, and I hacked Mew into the game, and I made it my starter Pokemon. That's the only thing I changed about the game. And I played the whole game with Mew and loved it.
Oh, that's great. All right, let's give it up for Justin. All right, so let's go ahead and go over our trivia answers, and then I'll announce the winner, or who didn't win. All right. Which constellation holds the hottest place in the universe? That is Virgo. Which planet is known as the morning star? Venus. Which planet is known as the evening star? Also Venus. In what year did Pluto become reclassified as a dwarf planet? 2006, a sad year, a sad year. Rest in peace, Pluto. Which planets have rings around them? Let me read the answer. It's A, it's Saturn, Jupiter, Uranus, and Neptune. What happens if you fall into a black hole? Spaghettification. That is an actual scientific term, is spaghettification. All right, what is the term for the condition where three celestial bodies are arranged in a straight line? And yes, we know that that picture is not a straight line.
It is syzygy. A very fun word to say once you know how to pronounce it. All right. Every second, the sun releases energy equivalent to how many nuclear bombs? 100 billion. What is the most common type of star found in the Milky Way? Red dwarfs. And lastly, what is the name of the most prominent ring of Saturn? The B ring. All right. So I can tell you who definitely didn't win, and that is our department chair in the back of physics and astronomy. I won't announce his score, though, because that was requested, but I feel like I should. I don't know. I mean, you did kind of harsh on the astronomers in the room earlier, so I kind of had to get back at you for that. All right, we had two winners. They were tied. First winner is Aaron. Aaron. There's only a first name. This is. That's you. Okay, congratulations. All right. And our second winner is Andrew. Did you guys cheat off of each other? I'm kidding. All right, so congratulations on winning trivia. You can go to our merch table and grab a merch item and get those raffle tickets out. It's my favorite part of the night. All right. This one feels lucky. All right. We have 3, 0, 5, 5, 1, 8. Oh, I think this is an astronomy on tap first. You got it? 305-518? Amazing. This is an astronomy on tap first. We got a winner on the first draw. What's up, Cassidy? What was the most missed question? That's an interesting statistic. We'll have to think about that for next time. I have no idea. But I'll let you know. Yes. The hottest place in the universe? I should know this. It was question A. It was answer A. I just spilled. It was Virgo, the Virgo constellation. I didn't make the trivia. Valerie? Anyway, thank you guys so much. If you won for the raffle, you can also go pick up a free merch item as well. But thank you guys so much for coming tonight. We hopefully will see you in December. If not, we will see you in February. Our January show will actually be hosted in New Orleans. So if you guys get a chance, we're going to be out there for the AAS meeting. But we will be hopefully doing a show in New Orleans. So come check us out. And with that, have a good night, everyone.